The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to our Sunday service. I just wanted to tell everyone that so far everyone at our church has been COVID virus free. And I hope everyone is staying safe and keeping themselves well. As of right now, the session has decided that we're going to follow the guidelines of the presbytery and we're going to continue with our social distancing. So for at least a short time in the future, your services will be coming to you via video. An exciting new thing that's going to start on May 31st is we are going to come to you live. We're going to email you the link. We're going to make the link available on Facebook. We'll start our service at 10:30, just like every other normal service, and it'll be from start to finish. So pray for us. It's been a while since we've done a service from start to finish, and we just hope that we're able to connect with you on a spiritual level on our Sunday morning services. I have had questions about offerings being sent to the church. We are checking our mail regularly, daily, and we are doing weekly deposits from the church. So if you would like to mail your offering in, you can. If you have a key to the church, of course, obviously, you can bring it up as an elder and put it in the box. Let us worship our God.
Thank you.
Please join me in our call to worship. Let the righteous be joyful. Let us exalt before God. Let us be jubilant with joy.
Sing to God. Sing praises to his name. Lift up a song to him who rides upon the clouds. His name is the Lord. Be exalted before him. Father of orphans and protector of widows, God in his holy habitation.
God gives the desolate a home to live in. He leads out the prisoners to prosperity, but the rebellious live in a parched land.
Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord, O rider in the heavens. Ascribe power to God, whose majesty is over Israel, and whose power is in the skies. Awesome is God in his sanctuary, the God of Israel. He gives power and strength to his people. Blessed be God.
Please join me for our opening hymn, Spirit of the Living God, number 322. Please join me with our call to confession. The word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before God, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Lord,
we come before you this morning, seeking your blessing. Most of the time, we think we're doing pretty well. We haven't murdered anyone. We haven't committed adultery. We make a lie sometimes, but they're just little ones. We may even begin to think we're righteous, but you remind us, if we call anyone a fool, that we are in danger of hellfire. If we look at a person with lust in our hearts, we have already committed adultery. Lord, hear us now as we confess our sins before you.
Now receive this assurance of pardon. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse nor harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
two, three, four.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, so I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. Heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
One, two, three, four.
Let us pray. O God, your word is more precious than fine gold and sweeter than the purest honey. As we turn to your scripture, send your Holy Spirit to infuse your word with truth and grace, so that the good news of your love would shine before our eyes and delight our senses, so that we cannot help but to respond with wonder, faith, and trust. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is from the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 6 through 14. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all of Judah and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, as a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were consistently devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers.
Thank you, Summer. Our reading continues this morning with the 17th chapter of John, verses 6 through, oh my gosh, I'm lost. No, John 17, 1 through 11, pardon me. Listen for the word of the Lord. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." This is the word of the Lord. Got to hand it to the disciples. Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? They are focused and persistent. Jesus has appeared to the disciples. This is after the resurrection, and they're still getting their heads around what that means. And clearly something big is going on, but how big? What are the ramifications? What is the scope of the resurrection? And it soon becomes apparent that the biggest imaginings of men don't even begin to measure up to what God has planned. The biggest thing that the disciples can think of is an Israel back on the heap of world powers, the world order, Israel being returned to glory. And fair enough, they're thinking about scripture and prophecy, and David's house, we remember, was supposed to reign forever. In the 37th chapter of Ezekiel, we read, "My servant David shall be king over them, and they shall all have one shepherd. They shall follow my ordinance and be careful to observe my statutes. They shall live in the land that I gave to my servant Jacob, in which your ancestors lived, they and their children, and their children's children shall live there forever. And my servant David shall be their prince forever. I will make a covenant of peace with them, It will be an everlasting covenant with them, and I will bless them and multiply them, and will set my sanctuary among them forevermore. My dwelling place shall be with them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Then the nations will know that I, the Lord, sanctify Israel when my sanctuary is among them forevermore. So there it is. It's God's promise. It's interesting to put this in context that during this time, when this prophecy, when Ezekiel was speaking, that Israel had split into two kingdoms. The kingdom in the north is Israel, and the southern kingdom is Judah, which included Jerusalem. And David had managed to unite Israel during his lifetime, but it was really relatively short-lived. Solomon, who we all know was renowned for his wisdom, still didn't end so well. He began to wander from God. He had all kinds of wives, foreign wives, and they had influence on him, and he wound up building shrines to the Moabite and Ammonite gods, which is very ecumenical, but as far as these ordinances and statues went, kind of fell short of that. And so the split occurred after Solomon's death when his son Rehoboam took the throne, and Rehoboam followed in his father's footsteps and had imposed even heavier taxes to fund building projects. And it didn't sit very well with the 12 tribes, which were really still 12 tribes loosely aligned together. They'd come together against the Philistines, but you know, Israel could only stand so much, and we all understand that. You get the picture. It's death and taxes more than theology. So the prophecy was talking about these two kingdoms being reunited once more under one Davidic king, David. The two kingdoms united will live in the land that God gave Jacob, and David would be their prince forever. And when you read this, it kind of makes you wonder, like, well, what? Because we know David died, so obviously they're speaking spiritually here, and David is a type of king, and in turn, a type of Christ. Kings. Israel had asked for a king so that they could be like other nations, and they got their wish. The history of Israel's kings is definitely checkered. The biggest percentage of those kings were losers, apostates who fell far short of King David's example, or even the example of Solomon. Most of them were political animals seeking the best deals they could get with the powers that were active in their milieu. They were not kings after God's own heart. Up until Jesus' time, it must have looked as if the prophecies and the prophets were out of their mind. Again, Solomon had his problems. Rehoboam began well, ended poorly with more idol worship. And so it goes. By Jesus' time, the king of Israel was Herod, who was a puppet king put in place by the Romans. He wasn't even an Israelite. He was raised as a Jew, but he was not worried about statutes, ordinances, and things like that. And he was only remotely aware of God, but only just. Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel? And God had something much more radical than another crummy little monarchy. Jesus, the son of David, had indeed come to restore the kingdom, but the kingdom was way beyond local and way beyond temporal. Jesus' kingdom is clearly not of this earth. Not to toot our own horns, but Jesus' kingdom, you know, winds up being us. We're the church. And Jesus' kingdom exists in his followers' hearts and mind, and it is eternal. It's ironic to see the disciples trying to understand this new thing that God is doing, and we face the same challenges today, you know. It's kind of a fine line. We are doing the same thing that Israel was doing. The people of God must be simultaneously faithful to the past, observing God's ordinance and standards, but at the same time be malleable to be able to see the new things God may be doing in our midst. And it gets to be quite a balancing act, and lots of debate goes on about that. What, you know, Faithful involves tradition and the way we've done things in the past, and tradition is good until we mistake our traditions for God, or the traditions actually become God, or they get in God's way. Tradition, we can assume that there are some things that will never change. I think it's safe to say, love our neighbors as ourselves. That should be safe. Love those who persecute you. That's a little harder. And even the ones that are not intuitive at all, like turn the other cheek, those are things that we will continue to do. These things seem to be constant, but we're supposed to be shining God's light into a fallen and frequently dark world. The angels questioned to the disciples, I get a kick out of this, the angels questioned to the disciples as Jesus is ascending into heaven, really kind of amuses me. They come down there and they ask the disciples, why do you stand looking up into heaven? Well, you know, I mean, that's not something you see every day, but there's an implication in this, and it's really pretty simple. It's like, get moving, you know. Jesus has just gone up into heaven. Now it's your turn to do something. And the reading ends with the disciples returning to the upper room where they join the remaining disciples and Mary, Jesus' mother, brothers and sisters in prayer. And they remain there in prayer until Pentecost. And I suppose they were seeking guidance because it'd take a while to figure out what you're supposed to do. And prayer is a good place to start to look for what God wants. The tendency is to try to stay on the mountaintop. And when we have a close encounter with God, we tend to want to stay there. It's a good place to be. It feels good. It feels right. It feels safe to have God right there. He's going to keep us safe. But we're supposed to go out into the world and fight that good fight that Paul talks about. So like that old movie, Heaven Can Wait. And it's interesting. We'd like to go to our rewards before we've really done anything to be rewarded for. I guess human nature is that way. In John 17, Jesus is in dialogue with God, and he states clearly that he's no longer in the world, but his followers are, and he's asking God to look after them and protect them. The problem with all of this for believers is that if we're being followers of Christ, we are necessarily going to make waves. That's just the way it is. If we're being faithful, we make waves by our very nature. And we are going to disturb the order of this world. We don't just baptize it and turn our backs on it. We will defy this world's order as Jesus did. Jesus said, for the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. Jesus gave his disciples God's word. He gave himself. I thought about this in the beginning. John, first chapter of John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What was come into being in him was life, and the life and the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. It's no small job being the light in this world. Frankly, it's entirely impossible without the Holy Spirit, and it's a good thing Pentecost is coming. First Pentecost gave birth to the church, and all that prayer in that upper room paid off, gave birth to something new in the world. Christianity operates on a couple of basic premises that are, again, constant. Gets back to these things that we're supposed to do. Love your neighbor, be nice and gentle, take care of widows and orphans and so forth. As Peter said, there's no law against doing these things. But the other basic tenet of Christianity is that might does not make right. You look at the Bible, little guys turn out to be the winners, the first will be last. David managed to prevail and slay Goliath. So worldly might can be dangerous. And of course, the world operates on this premise, be strong and be safe. Teddy Roosevelt said, speak softly and carry a big stick. Or dropping the metaphor and going to plain English, the exercise of intelligent forethought and of decisive action sufficiently far in advance of action. So, diplomacy, I guess. It has sort of evolved to speak softly and bring a few armored divisions. And sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. This sort of diplomacy is wise and works pretty well, but it's really not what Jesus had in mind, right? Jesus' kingdom is peace. The lion will lie down with the lamb, the world will be transformed. There will be no more need for gunboat diplomacy. We're not there yet, but that's what we're working for. And this is how the glory of the Lord will manifest itself and how God will glorify his name. I admit that it's good to be prepared. The world is plagued by human kings, and they haven't really changed too much in 2,000 years. Bad kings, human beings who lust after power, oligarchs, despots, dictators, who seek to enslave their neighbors in one way or another. It pays to beware. Jesus again said, all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. Once again, and I feel like I'm saying this a lot, but it's always true, we are the Lord's ambassadors. We are not of this world. And in this sense, it is certainly true. When we work for peace in God's kingdom, we do glorify our God and our Lord. And in doing so, we glorify God's name. Let us pray. Lord, help us to be your light in this world. It's a wonderful world, but it is not the kingdom of heaven. And so, Lord, help us to work for justice. Help us to speak the truth in love. Help us to take your light out into the world and tell everybody about the good news of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Would you please join me now in hymn number 379, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Trust the Spirit.
It is time now for joys and concerns, prayers of the people. Anybody got any prayer concerns? Nobody's mailing them in, and I'm kind of losing track, so it's going to be a little redundant, I think. But that's okay. Oh boy.
They're still at home.
Well, let's go before the Lord in prayer. We have much to be thankful for, and blessings abound. They're all around us. If we slow down in our busy days just to savor the flavor, smell the coffee, Lord, for the people that we love, for the friends at our sides, even though they're 6 feet apart from us, we give thanks. We give thanks for the fact that no one in the church at St. Andrew's has COVID-19. We're grateful for that. We lift our concerns before you. We pray for Bill and Helen Starks. We pray for Helen for strength. We give thanks for her good spirit. We give thanks for the people that minister to her body, for the home health care people. For Linda, who is still recovering from surgery on her knee, Lord, we ask that you would make sure that that infection is gone. I pray for my friend Luke Shepler, who has a nasty infection, and the antibiotics don't seem to be taking care of it. We pray for Beth and Tony, who are working at Walmart as part of those essential services, and they've come down with COVID-19, so Lord, be with them. We pray for the leadership of this nation as we come into an election year. It's like, Lord, you say you will never put more on us than we can stand, but sometimes it makes me wonder. It was like COVID-19, killer bees, hurricanes, and now I saw what there was. It was a joke, but it was a super volcano out around Mount Rushmore, and I thought, well, yeah, I'd believe that. It seems like we've been beset by lots of things, and Lord, we know, unfortunately, sadly, we have to admit that when we're faced with trials, we are certainly more attentive to you, and we're looking for you in our lives. So, Lord, give us your strength, give us your peace, help us to remember that you are for us, you're not against us, that you love us. We pray all of these things now in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And this is the place in the service where if we had ushers and you were sitting out there, we would take a collection. And Summer has mentioned it. We, of course, still rely on your offerings. And you can put those in the mailbox, I guess. And I'm telling yeah, the mailbox. Yeah, so... as far as I know, nobody's yelled too much about offering, so I'm assuming that you've all been faithful, and we're grateful for that. But don't forget, you can still give. Well, let's see. Let's do the doxology, Kathy.
Doxology?
I don't know. Can you do the doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
let's close with our final hymn, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus, number 144. Receive this charge and benediction, go out into the world in peace. And now unto the one who is able to keep us from falling and present us without spot before the presence of the Lord's glory with rejoicing, through the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, be all majesty, glory, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen. Depart in peace.
Serve the Lord.